His statue greets visitors at some of California's most popular locations, the 21 missions, from San Diego in the south to Sonoma in the north. In California, streets, schools, parks, even a freeway and a mountain peak bear his name. He is Junipero Serra, a Franciscan priest who founded the California missions and shaped much of the early history of the state and region. In January of 2015, Pope Francis announced Serra's canonization, but in many areas of the United States, he is largely unknown. Who is this newest saint? Junipero Serra was born in 1713 in the small agricultural village of Petra on the Mediterranean island of Mallorca. He entered the Franciscan order at the age of 16 in Palma, the island's capital. After a year's novitiate, he took his vows as a Franciscan. On that occasion, he changed his name from his given name of Miguel to Junipero, in honor of Brother Juniper, one of the early companions of St. Francis of Assisi. In the Franciscan tradition, Brother Juniper was noted for humility and simplicity, and Serra's choice of that name signaled his desire to incorporate those virtues more deeply into his own life. After studies in philosophy and theology, he was ordained a priest in 1737 and continued graduate studies in theology and became an eminent professor at the Pontifical University in Palma. His academic specialization was the thought of John Duns Scotus, an important 13th century Franciscan thinker whose theology emphasized God's boundless love for all his creatures. When school was not in session, Serra preached in many towns and villages throughout the island.
In 1744, Father Serra preached a series of Lenten sermons to a convent of nuns, of poor clares, in the convent of St. Clair in Palma, in Mallorca. And he chose as the overall theme for these sermons one of the verses from the Psalms, Psalm 33. And the verse was, "Taste and see that the Lord is good." And in his sermon, Serra developed this notion of tasting and seeing God's goodness, and especially tasting. And he developed the notion of God as sweetness, of God as delicious, a kind of a culinary delight. If you've never tasted it, you really don't know what you're missing. But once you taste it, you find that you have an increasing taste for it, a liking for it.
At some point in the late 1740s, Serra appears to have become unhappy with academic life. Even though he had proven to be quite successful as a professor, he felt that he was not responding to his deepest desires. An alternative path presented itself to him. Mallorca, since it was located on a number of important Mediterranean trade routes, had always been an outward-looking island. One of the most important Franciscan figures in Mallorcan history was Ramon Llull, a member of the Third Order of St. Francis, who had, in the 13th century, traveled to North Africa to preach the gospel among the Muslim population there. As a Mallorcan Franciscan, Junipero Serra was heir to this outward-looking and missionary tradition. So in 1749, he volunteered to become a missionary in Spanish America and left Mallorca. But as the oldest child, he was quite concerned about the parents he was leaving behind.
And there were letters in which Junipero Serra, the son, the child, was trying to deal with his emotions with regard to his aging parents. For example, he wrote a letter from Cadiz as he was preparing to set sail to cross the Atlantic. And in this letter, a very touching letter to a priest in Mallorca, he expresses how he feels at the possibility of never seeing his aging parents again. His language is a real mix of sadness and joy, anticipation, regret, enthusiasm, and melancholy. And this is just an excerpt from the letter written on August 20th, 1749. My beloved friend, I am at a loss for words, yet overwhelmed by emotion as I depart. I beg you once again to comfort my parents. I know they will be greatly affected by my leaving. I wish I could instill in them the great joy that I am experiencing, because I believe they would urge me to go forth and never turn back.
Serra arrived in Veracruz, Mexico in December of that year. As a way of strengthening himself for what he knew would be the challenging missionary labors that awaited him, he elected to walk some 200 miles from Veracruz to Mexico City. During that trek, he was bitten by an insect, and his leg became seriously infected. This wound resulted in periodic pain, at times quite intense for the rest of his life. After 6 months, at the Colegio de San Fernando, the Franciscan missionary headquarters in Mexico City, Serra was assigned to the Sierra Gorda, a remote and rugged region approximately 250 miles north of Mexico City. This region had been evangelized by Franciscan missionaries during the decade before Serra arrived in Mexico. In the Sierra Gorda, Serra ministered to the Palme Indians. For at least 3 of the 8 years he spent in the region, he served as president of the 5 Franciscan missions in the vicinity: Santiago de Jalpan, where he lived; Santa Maria del Agua de Landa; San Francisco del Valle de Tilaco; Nuestra Señora de la Luz de Tancoyol; and San Miguel Conca. During the time Serra spent in the Sierra Gorda, the construction of at least some of the great stone churches in the region was initiated. The facades of these churches are stunning, and in 2003, they were declared a World Heritage Cultural Site by UNESCO. Serra spent most of his time in the Sierra Gorda attending to the spiritual and material needs of the Palme people. He learned the local indigenous language well enough that he was able to translate a number of basic prayers, devotions, and catechetical instructions into that language. He also assisted them in improving the agricultural activities associated with the missions. Serra also struggled against the attempts of soldiers and settlers to encroach upon mission lands, which he insisted belonged to the Indians. Serra left the Sierra Gorda in 1758 and spent the next 9 years in Mexico City. He also gave a series of revival missions in various locations throughout the Mexican mainland. He was part of a group of friars who would enter various dioceses and parishes at the invitation of the local bishop and preach a series of sermons designed to spark a renewal of religious enthusiasm in the area. When he was preaching one of these missions in 1767, he was suddenly recalled to Mexico City. There he was informed that King Carlos III had expelled the Jesuits from the Spanish Empire, and the Franciscans had been assigned to take over the former Jesuit missions in Baja California. He arrived at the former Jesuit headquarters in Loreto in 1768 in high spirits. His enthusiasm increased when the Spanish government decided to expand the frontier farther north to occupy San Diego and Monterey, to forestall a potential Russian incursion into California from Alaska. The Baja California missionaries were asked to be part of this process. As their leader, Serra agreed and decided that he himself would participate. For Serra, the move into Upper or Alta California represented the culmination of a dream that had led him to leave his homeland almost 20 years earlier. He greatly desired to be a missionary among people who had never heard the gospel, yet he had not been able to do so in America. The Palme people, among whom he ministered in the Sierra Gorda, and the native peoples of Baja California had both been evangelized before he arrived among them. The move north promised to put him in contact with unbaptized native peoples. One of the most emotional days of his life occurred on May 15th, 1769, when this lifelong dream finally became a reality at the Baja California site of Velicata. He wrote in his diary,
"For me, it was a day of great consolation. Soon after the masses were said, while I was quiet with my thoughts in the small hut that was my dwelling place, they alerted me that the Gentiles were approaching and that they were close. I praised God, kissed the ground, and gave thanks to our Lord for granting me this opportunity to be among the Gentiles in their land after longing for this for so many years. I quickly went out, and there I saw 12 Gentiles, all of them grown men, with the exception of one boy who was about 10 years old, and the other who was about 16 years old. I saw what I could hardly believe when I would read about it or when I would be told about it, which was that the Gentiles were totally naked, like Adam in paradise before the fall."
The Spanish expedition reached San Diego in 1769 and Monterey in 1770. At both places, the Spanish founded a fort, or presidio, and a mission church. Originally, the mission was very close to the presidio, and in Monterey, Serra quickly found the location to be undesirable. It was not a place where native inhabitants of the region could taste and see the goodness of the Lord as he preached in Palma in 1744.
When Father Serra arrived in Monterey in 1770 with Gaspar de Portola, the governor, Portola chose a place for the presidio, and they established that presidio on the Monterey Peninsula, basically where it is right now in Church Street in Monterey. And that was a good spot for the presidio because it was fairly close to the ocean. And one of the things that the presidio was supposed to do was defend the Spanish possession against maritime incursions, especially perhaps from the Russians. So it was a great spot for the presidio. But Serra wasn't there for more than 2 weeks before we see him writing back to people in Mexico City, "You know, this is not a good spot for the missions." And the reason he thought this was not a good spot for a mission was pretty simple. There were no Indian villages around. The Indians in the area generally lived in the Carmel, along the Carmel River, in what's now the Carmel Valley. And Serra wanted the mission to be close to where the Indians were, so that Indians could come and gradually be exposed to what he regarded as the truths of Christianity. And so, literally, after a couple of weeks in the Presidio, Serra is saying, "No, we've got to move the mission closer to where the Indians are." And he finally was able to do that in 1771 and move the mission from the Presidio to Carmel, where it still is now.
Missions had been a basic element of Spanish colonial expansion for over two centuries. Originally designed by members of religious orders as a way of protecting native peoples from exploitation by early conquistadores, ranchers, and miners, the mission system evolved over time to become a major element of Spanish expansion. Missions were designed as places where native peoples could be assimilated into Spanish ways, notably by adopting Catholicism and learning European-style agriculture. In California, Junipero Serra moved quickly to establish a number of missions. Under his presidency, 8 such institutions were initiated in the first 8 years of the Spanish occupation of California. San Diego de Alcalá, among the Cumiai people. San Carlos, among the Rumsen Ohlone people. San Antonio de Padua, among the Salinan people. San Gabriel Arcángel, among the Tongva people. San Luis Obispo de Tolosa, among the Chumash people. San Juan Capistrano, among the Ahakamen people. San Francisco de Asís, among the Yelamu Ohlone people. And Santa Clara de Asís, among the Tamien Ohlone people. A 9th mission, San Buenaventura, was founded among the Chumash people in 1782. Native peoples entered the mission system for a variety of reasons. A major reason was the developing ecological crisis that the Spanish occupation was creating in their homeland.
So for the Ohlones of the San Francisco Bay Area, my people, the oak tree was our staple of life. On an oak tree grows an acorn. An acorn is like a walnut or an almond. It has a hard shell, and you crack the shell, inside is the soft meal that you would then grind to make flour. The horse, the pig, the goat, every animal loved the acorns. So the animals come in and they begin to eat the staple of life for Native peoples. So the Native peoples are experiencing the destruction of their environment through these animals. Animals run away. The animals are getting to the far outlands, surrounding missions, before the missionaries even get there. And they're destroying the environment because the acorn, well turned into flour, was also that would entice the deer, the elk, the bear to come down from the hills that the Indians could then hunt with their bow and arrow all this fresh meat, as it were. Well, now those animals aren't coming down to eat acorns. So what happens is the natural environment is destroyed by Spanish occupation.
While the missions could be a source of food, missionaries and native peoples had a complex relationship within the missions. The missionaries genuinely regarded themselves as protectors and benefactors of the native peoples. They genuinely believed they were offering them the possibility of eternal salvation.
The entire missionary enterprise, whether it was the Franciscans, the Dominicans, or other groups of mendicant friars, their primary mission, if you will, was in fact to evangelize. They saw the evangelical enterprise, the conversion of indigenous peoples to Christianity, as a godsend, as an opportunity to save souls.
The native peoples generally regarded the missions from within the framework of their own religious beliefs. Since the missions had been imported into their own ancestral territory, they regarded them as places in which their traditional religious beliefs existed alongside the tenets of Catholicism.
So that's our relationship with the missions. As far as indigenous people go, we believe that when we pass on to the next world, we become one with the soil. From there comes the trees, the mud, all that goes into the adobe bricks, the logs in there. So we are actually part of the missions as well. So as indigenous people, we believe that we are not just working in them, but we're actually inside the walls. We're actually there. So it's a living legacy for us.
Often, Indians would desire to leave the mission and return to their traditional villages. Priests would generally give permission for visits of limited duration. But if the Indians did not return on time, soldiers would be sent out to bring them back. For the missionaries believed that the eternal salvation of baptized Indians depended upon their continued growth in the faith and reception of the sacraments, which were only available at the missions. If the Indians were captured and returned, they would be punished. This aspect of mission life is difficult to condone in the 21st century.
Often enough, they were punished with whipping and flogging. This was the basic punishment, you know, in the Spanish army, and it became the punishment in areas of the frontier controlled, as California was, by the army. But the flogging was meant to be a punishment, and it was pretty severe. And the missionaries asked the soldiers to flog the Indians, and Indians, especially these so-called fugitives, were routinely flogged when they were returned.
In the midst of this complex situation, where Indians were invited into the mission but coerced to remain there, Junipero Serra continued to regard his own role as a benevolent one. After one missionary had been killed at Mission San Diego, he wrote to the viceroy with this advice about what should happen if an Indian should kill him.
One of the most important things I requested of the visitor general at the beginning of these conquests was that if the Indians were to kill me, whether they be Gentiles or Christians, they should be forgiven.
Serra's perspective about the native peoples with whom he was dealing was consistently religious and positive. In this, he knew he was out of step with many other Spaniards in the New World.
If you read his writings, he describes their nature, and he's not condescending about it, which for me is surprising, given the number of condescending people of the time who, in their colonialist zeal, tended to see native and indigenous peoples in almost a derogatory light. Serra wasn't there with that. He does not refer to them as savages. He does not refer to them in any belittling fashion.
In his late 60s, Serra undertook a series of arduous journeys to all nine missions in order to administer the sacrament of confirmation. These occasions afforded him the opportunity personally to interact with virtually every baptized Indian in California, and he relished the opportunity to do so. On August 28, 1784, at Mission San Carlos, he was visited by two old friends who had recently returned from a voyage to Peru. He was visibly weak, and he knew he was near death. But he tried to put his visitors at ease and told them,
"Well, senores, after so much time that has passed since we last saw one another, and after all of your travels, I thank you for coming to this port from so far away to throw a bit of earth on top of me."
Shortly after, he retired to his simple room and died in his sleep. The nine missions Serra founded and the additional 12 that were founded after his death still exist. By the time the missions were terminated in the mid-1830s, the Indian death rate far exceeded the birth rate in most of them, and many indigenous cultures of California had been suppressed or destroyed within the mission chain. The missions that visitors can see today are generally 19th century and early 20th century reconstructions of the original structures. Many of them are functioning Catholic parishes. Given their complex history, many native people of California have a conflicted relationship to them. One indigenous Californian describes an experience that highlights the gaps in understanding and perception that can cluster around the California missions.
"A few years ago, I walked into the mission. We were up here, we were doing a ceremony, and I couldn't find my moccasins for some reason in the 15-passenger van. Then I had some tobacco and some sage with me, and because there's a lot of things that you feel there, right? So you want to be protected. So I was coming in, doing my prayer, laying down some tobacco, and someone approached me and said that I wasn't allowed to do witchcraft there, that I had to leave. And I was kind of confused because I go, well, it's not witchcraft. I'm not a witch. Like, I'm indigenous. I'm actually laying a prayer, and I'll take a prayer now. I'll take a moment to pray for you in that manner because you're coming at me crazy, you know? And so I was escorted out of the mission."
The bishops of California and the western province of the Franciscan Order in the United States have stated that they hope that Junipero Serra's canonization might spark respectful dialogue and reconciliation among all those affected by and interested in the California missions. Truly, such dialogue and reconciliation would be the greatest legacy of Junipero Serra's canonization.